listening to I Am Refocused Radio with your host, Shamaya Reed. This show is designed to inspire you to live your purpose and regain your focus. And now, here's your host, Shamaya Reed.
Hey, welcome to I Am Refocused Radio. We are here once again today. We have another amazing show. We have our special guest today, Ms. Rachael Jayne Groover, and she is the founder of theawakenschool.com. And she is going to tell us about her amazing story. Not only was she an accomplished singer and songwriter from Australia, but she helps people and she does amazing things here in the U.S., speaking, teaching, and also is a published author. She has an amazing book that we're going to discuss too today. And that's not coming out until later this year in October, but the title of the book is Unshakable Inner Peace. Get off the mental and emotional roller coaster for good. Without further ado, I want to welcome you, Rachael Jayne, to the show. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, Shamaya. Thanks so much for having me.
Well, I appreciate you taking time out of your schedule. I know you're super busy. So let's dive into your background before we get to the book. Tell the audience a little bit about your music career and how did you get started into all this amazing coaching?
Yeah, I was singing full-time in Australia when I was younger. I was singing, songwriting, gigging a lot. But I think what really drew me to performing was more about presence and stage presence and what creates an experience for an audience. I've always been fascinated with that, why certain people can walk on stage or walk into a situation and they just have that it factor about them. And I studied that along with voice and songwriting and guitar and piano and other things that I could get my hands on. But it got to a point where, yeah, I was doing it full time, probably a lot of people's dreams. I was, doing well, but I felt like I was just entertaining people for entertainment's sake. And I really wanted to make a greater difference in people's lives and go beyond just that, you know, concert or that night in the bar or what have you, and really create change for people. And that's why I started thinking about speaking and coaching and running experiences. We run workshops, retreats all around the world now, and I've just definitely found my home more here. And we get to sing. My husband, I met, he's a bass player, and his name's Dada Groover, so it's always cool to tell people he's a bass player with last name Groover. and we still play at our events and things, which is great. We sometimes surprise people with a full band and they don't know that we've had this background of music, and that's really cool to see their faces go, what? They just knew me as a teacher and an author. But yeah, it's still, I think, all comes back to this word presence and awakening to our own presence and awakening to the moment and awakening our mind and our heart and our spirit to have a much better life than what we, you know, sometimes are faced with.
And speaking of what you're doing today, I mean, you kind of touched on how people are surprised that you have a music background, you and your husband. But talk to us a little bit about that transition from one career to your next one, where you're, you know, a speaker, a teacher, an author in the United States, making this transition as a career move. What was it like? Was it scary?
Yeah, well, it was. I really felt drawn to the U.S. For quite a few years. It was kind of something I was trying to manifest for myself, and back then it was not easy to get a visa or just be able to walk in here and have someone, want to hire you. But I stayed on it for two reasons. I had an intuitive sense that my man was living in the US, which he was. I met my husband pretty soon after I moved here. And I also, back then, and we're talking about like 1999, 2000, I was so healthily addicted to watching Oprah and all of the people that she was having on a show back then. I don't know if you're too young to remember that or if anyone is too young or old to remember that. But she had, you know, Gary Zukav and Ian LaVancent and Dr. Phil and all these people. And it was very early on in the personal development industry being really a big thing, which it is now. And I was just fascinated with all of those people and never thought that I would be in that industry myself. I just really loved it. And I started doing small circles, small groups, moved to America, and I ended up working with an author and facilitator and someone who would travel around the world in his work. And I guess that was fate, wasn't it? I just learned the ropes with other people and met a lot of them along the way and was like, I think I can do this. And of course, when you think you can do this or you have a big dream, is what is a big difference between having the dream and actually making it happen as a business. So I went through that chapter of not really understanding how to do it as a business and how to really make an impact and have a spiritually centered, conscious business at the same time. So took a little bit, but studied and looked at other people and what they were doing and have brought those two words together that I use a lot in my work, spiritual and successful. And all of our work is helping those people now that want to be spiritual. They're very spiritually centered. They've been on a meditation path or a spiritual path of their choosing for many decades, and it's very important to them, but they also want to be a success. And how do you bring those two things together? And that's been my privilege to help conscious entrepreneurs and other people that want to make a positive impact do that and make good money at it, as well as their spiritual awakening journey at the same time.
We're talking to our guest today, Rachael Jayne Groover. And when you look at what you're doing, I mean, you're making a significant impact worldwide, being recognized worldwide with your two popular classes and trainees. Tell us a little bit about these two programs and how you position yourself to be able to use these programs to reach massive people.
Yeah, well, the first one that I was most well known for is called Art of Feminine Presence. And that came out of my first book, Powerful and Feminine, which is all about women really embodying more of their magnetism, more of their magnetic presence, and being able to receive the attention that they want. So, you know, if anyone's struggling with feeling like they're a little invisible or not being seen or not being heard, or maybe wanting to be, you know, in a similar way to me, of being seen in your career or as an expert, you've got to have a level of magnetism and a level of communication that people want to listen to. So I did that program many, many places around the world for now 13, 14 years. We've had 14,000 women go through that training. And I was hearing along the way, the men, you know, why can't we come? We'll wear heels, you know, and all of that. Like, well, it's just a women's feast right now, because it was so focused on helping women connect to their feminine, because a lot of women disconnect from their feminine. I did. And I thought, well, that's weak, or that's not, you know, politically correct. Or, you know, I grew up in the Alanis Morissette age. So it's like, no, I don't want to be needy or weak or what have you. But in that process, I disconnected from my feminine essence and learned how to reconnect to that, and then taught it. And it was very popular, because a lot of women still now, they defend against really being home in their sexual essence, their sensuality, their femininity, and being able to be really powerful in that way. So that is still something that we teach a few times a year. And then now I teach Art of Masculine Presence, which is the same practices. It's 44 practices that significantly increase somebody's ability to be seen and heard and inspire change. And the guys, it's me and a group of really courageous guys who want to do their inner work. And you know, it started with the magnetism and being seen, but it really did quickly move to what this new book is about, Unshakable Inner Peace, of how to quieten the mind and how to be truly in the moment and get off that mental and emotional roller coaster. And I think that's what a lot of guys come to that work for. They're kind of sick of the underlying anxiety or fear or worry or doubt or maybe anger issues, or they just, the mind won't stop. It just keeps racing. And so I think it's all about that. So that's one of the programs. And then Awaken Your Impact, our business training, is for people who are on that consciousness path, have been on a spiritual journey for a long time, but they have a business and they want to learn from someone else who's done it, but also has stayed in a really wonderful relationship and very healthy and happy and holy and all of that. So they come to us to learn how we built this multi seven-figure-a-year business, staying in our integrity and our spiritually centered, you know, place.
You have over 300 certified teachers working with you. Your programs, they are, like I said earlier, a worldwide impact, reaching people all around the world. How do you ensure consistency and effectiveness of your programs as they are being taught by various instructors around the world?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, well, everyone can go to artoffemininepresence.com and find a teacher near you if you're interested in doing it locally, or email us. And it's what those teachers go through is a 6-day training with me, and then usually they go through another 6 days and then another 4 days, depending on what level they want to go to. But we talk every month. We are doing trainings with them every month. They have to go through certain hoops, you know, to make sure they stay in the certification. And a lot of the training that you would get if you did an Art of Feminine Presence or Art of Masculine Presence group, it's very much about the practice that I designed. And so someone could even read you the practice and you do it, and you would get a phenomenal amount out of it, because what it's all about is changing the way your mind, your body, and your brain communicate, and what's happening in your energetic signal, because everybody has a signal that they send, and people respond to that. And often people don't like the way people are responding to them, right? They don't see them, or they don't acknowledge them, or they create a lot of judgment, a lot of insecurity in other people. Sometimes they intimidate other people and they're trying to figure out why, and I don't mean to do that. Does that make sense, Shamaya? Like, everyone has a signal, and sometimes they don't know what they're sending, you know, and sometimes they do. And so I've put these practices together that no matter who you have, they can walk you through that, and you'll get huge awareness around why your life has been the way that it is. It goes way beyond mindset and way beyond manifestation. It goes to what is the energy that you are sending, and then how to change it immediately, particularly when you're under stress, you know, particularly when you're maybe got to shoot a video or do a podcast or be on a stage or have a difficult conversation with your kid or your partner. How to be unshakable. And that's, you know, that's what all the work is really about. It's awakening to your potential, but being unshakable no matter what. And that's why the book is actually the first of a 3-part trilogy called the Unshakable series. And the first one's Unshakable Inner Peace. But it goes beyond that, because if you can be unshakable in any situation, I mean, there's nothing that you can't do. That's where it becomes. And you have to get into your body and into your energy field to slow that nervous system down and feel that confidence and feel that authentic confidence that people perceive as a really authentic, present person.
It's almost like watching a favorite movie of your superhero, you know. Before you watch the movie, it's like, oh, wow, I get to watch so-and-so. And then when you watch the movie and there's conflict, and then you're like, oh, shoot, are they going to survive? And then most likely they will, because that's why they're a superhero. They always, you know, find a way to, you know, make something positive out of a negative situation. But back to your book, can you highlight some of the themes or principles from your book that someone who wants to read it, they can immediately start practicing it daily?
Yeah, well, I just want to pick up on your superhero comment, because that's, I think, what a lot of people feel like in their life. They have a dream, they have a goal, they have something. It's like, oh yeah, and I can feel like I'm the superhero, and I'm going to do it. But then something happens and it just squashes that dream, or they start procrastinating more, or that's been their habit most of their life, or they go for it and then the self-doubt starts kicking in, right? And then we're like, that's the movie that we're in. That's the roller coaster that most human beings are in. We are really superheroes. We can create amazing, amazing things. But every ego, every personality has these, you know, this kryptonite. Yeah. And the book is showing people, it shows you where your kryptonite is and how to stop it, how to unwind the contractions of the mind, self-doubt, judgment of yourself, of others, comparing yourself, fear, anxiety, depression, all of these things for good. Because what people do is if they just take, you know, the next business deal or the next Netflix movie or the next glass of wine, it's fleeting. And my own journey has been from that, like being a fairly happy and confident person teaching Art of Feminine Presence, to having a significant spiritual awakening experience or experiences that has left me in an unshakable inner peace that it doesn't stop. It doesn't, like when certain challenging things happen, I'm not in the old, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? And all the drama I used to play out, it's not happening anymore because of this book. This book was for me. If I can just share a little piece about it, I wasn't planning to write this book. I was in Hawaii about to write my next book, thinking it would be on how to make an impact in the world. And what came was a very clear voice. It was very clearly not my own. And I said, what's this book going to be about? And they said, what's the most important question of your life? That's what this book is going to be about. And I thought about it for a moment. And what the most important question for me at that time was, is it possible for me to reach enlightenment this lifetime? I was like, whoa, that's a pretty big question. That's a pretty big statement to even be asking that. But I had been with that for several months, realizing that even though I'd been on a spiritual journey for a long time, I didn't believe that, you know, what Eckhart Tolle was talking about or other spiritual gurus. I knew that I wasn't there. I knew I'd been on the path, but I knew I wasn't living in that unshakable inner peace place. And so I'm writing the book and this voice says, okay, that's what the book's going to be about. Is it possible to reach enlightenment? And it basically said, yes, but here are all the ways that you're in the trap, that you're in, that why it's not happening, even though you meditate every day, even though you have all your practices. And it was mind-blowing to have this conversation around what spiritual awakening really is and where I was missing the mark. And the day after I finished the book, it came through all in a few days while I was in Hawaii. Wrote about 10 hours a day straight, and it was a very profound experience. And then it threw me into this kind of altered, amazing reality that has stuck with me since, and that was 6 years ago.
Once again, listen to our episode on Refocus Radio, talking to our guest, Rachael Jayne Groover, and go to her website, theawakenschool.com. And let's zoom in on the whole inner peace thing. Because everybody, well, disclaimer, you can't say that on shows, most people they're searching for it, right? We yeah. want that every day, like for the most part. And yeah. when people read your book, what's some of the approaches that you use or techniques in your book that introduces readers to help anchor the sense of peace?
Yeah. Yeah. And people got to remember, this was kind of news to me. I was, the writing of the book was happening as I was asking questions. And I think the number one thing that was so not clear to me before the book and so clear after is that receptivity, being receptive to the moment, is the bridge to unshakable inner peace, no matter what happens. And I was like, well, what does that even mean, to be receptive? And I would practice it a lot. Like, okay, if I'm being receptive now here to this podcast and this interview, it's very different to be receptive to you and receptive to the audience that I can feel, at least energetically, versus, okay, I'm here and I'm going to say this and say that, and I've got to, you know, strategically make my life work. And I realized that, no, I'm actually receiving my life. And there's this, I think all the bridges that everyone goes through, we first try to survive our life. I mean, you know, we've all had challenging upbringings to a certain degree. We try to survive our life. And then we finally go, okay, it's not about surviving. I got to go out and find myself. I've got to find my life and do that. And then we find ourselves. And then it's like, well, I can create it. I can create my life, you know? And we get into this do manifestation. And I was very good at creating my life. You've read some of the few things that I've been able to create in my life, but I knew I wasn't just in this piece. And so with the move from creating your life, I'm the one creating my own reality, to I am receiving my life, and having an energetic field that is in receptivity all the time is the game changer. So that's one. It's really going to support you to understand what that means. And you'll feel it. You'll feel it. The mind will still, the anxiety will go, the joy will lift a lot quite fast. The other thing that's in the book too is how people stop too early in their self-awareness journey, right? Have you heard someone say, you've got to be aware of your thoughts, or you've got to be aware of your feelings, and it's not who you are, and that's the ego, and you can't identify with that, all those things. And I got what they meant. I knew I wasn't my thoughts. I knew I wasn't my body. I knew I wasn't my feelings, my emotions. I was watching those things, right? I was aware of those things. So I am that which is aware. But this book showed me that no, I'm not that awareness. I'm aware that I'm aware. I'm aware of this awareness. I'm aware of this witness that keeps commenting on all my thoughts and all my feelings, right? Do you listening know that you're not your thoughts because you're aware of your thoughts, but you also have thoughts about your thoughts? You know, oh, I shouldn't be thinking that right now. Or, oh, that's not going to help me manifest what I want. We have this commenting mind. And until I was able to stabilize living in the awareness that's aware of this commenter, this middleman, this thing that I thought I was this self-aware person, but I'm not. I'm aware of this self-aware person. Again, this might sound very esoteric to some of you, but it was a massive awakening for me, going from a relatively happy, healthy human being to experiencing peace that doesn't move. I mean, I can get stressed if I'm having a very, very difficult week. This week is one of them, actually. We are opening our retreat center in a few weeks. I've got a lot going on, but at the center of it, even though I might be under pressure, there's nothing going on. It's quiet. It's quiet. And that was not what happened before this book. And so I'm really excited for people to read it.
Yeah, it makes you think, because it's like, for example, when you look at the news, I mean, you hear on podcast shows all the time, but I'm going to say it because it's facts. When you watch the news, are they in a hurry to give you the best news to happen in the day? Or is it the opposite? So
exactly.
To me, it's like, that's the roller coaster that we always hop on. It's like, we don't want to hop on a roller coaster that's boring. We want to go on a roller coaster that's questionable. Like, is this safe to ride? We get a thrill in getting into a negative space. Not because we want to stay there, but it's more interesting to dwell on versus, oh, if everything was perfect, we'd all be robots. Like, it would just be a boring life. So the chaos helps us to appreciate the peace.
Exactly.
When you look at how you've been able to grow your business and your influence, both with music and with your school, what, at the end of the day, what are you hoping people will learn from Rachael Jayne?
I am hoping that they learn how to get off this mental and emotional roller coaster they're on. If that happens, then whatever you focus your mind on, you can manifest amazing things. But if you don't get off that roller coaster, you will create this and you'll create that, but it won't make you happy, or it'll make you happy for a little while, or you'll be super successful in one area and struggling in another. And that's why all the spiritual traditions of all time have seen this. And we know it intuitively that if we can truly awaken our mind and our heart and our body and not be in this tense place. Wow. Wow. So even though I teach people how to hit six figures and seven figures and multi-seven figures in their business, and even though I teach people how to write their books from this very receptive space, I say that's the thing that underlies everything, awakening to their spiritual essence, to their unlimited place, that once you know you're unlimited, there's no worry anymore. There's no doubt anymore. It's truly peace. Not boring.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't live a boring life, but
yeah, yeah. And I'm glad you said that, because what I meant by boring is the sometimes all the good things that are available seem boring to some people, because it's like, oh, it's too good to be true. You have one person that can think, well, if the sun's out, it's about to rain. Just give it some time.
Yeah.
But what you're saying is, well, yeah, it is going to rain, but this is a way you don't let that defeat what you're trying to do in life. In other words,
your mind and emotions can be still,
yeah,
and happy and grateful no matter what's blowing today.
That's the key. Yeah.
That's the key.
Yeah, that's exactly where I was headed. And when people listen to shows, you know, I had someone on recently and he discussed how, you know, it's the battle within. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not necessarily the battles that you're dealing with outside. It's the hardest battle you ever fight in life is the one in you.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, you're responsible.
Yeah.
Period.
Exactly. And this book is about how to end that battle. So it's not even a battle. And it's going into a whole nother realm of consciousness to do that. It's not what most people do. It's hard to understand sometimes. And that's why I'm so proud of this book, that it takes some very esoteric and challenging concepts and I think makes it a reality for a lot more people.
Man, that was good. Like we said, your book is coming out later this year, and people can go to your website, theawakenschool.com, for more information, for updates when the book is released.
Yes.
But last question for you. I mean, you're building all this. You built so much already. Do you look back and say, wow, like, man, we actually are seeing this dream become reality, or are you just that in tune with what you want to do and appreciate what you have ability to do and say?
I think it's more that, I think it's more in the moment these days. Hmm. Yeah. It's definitely in the future, like the big dreams of things, but it's time warps when you're in this space. It's like everything is now. It really is. So I'm just here with you. And see what's next.
I like that. Yeah, that's cool. Because, I mean, I had someone talk about that before, where they're just like living in the moment, living the now. You can only control what you're doing right now.
Exactly. Well, Thank you so much, Shamaya. I love this conversation.
Yeah, definitely. And I was just going to say, this is a perfect time for our audience to make a decision now and go visit your website, theawakenschool.com. Get ready for the book that's coming out later this year. It's called Unshakable Inner Peace, Get Off the Mental and Emotional Rollercoaster for Good. Once again, I've been talking to Rachael Jayne Groover on Ivory Folks Radio. I want to say again, thanks for your time.
Thank you.